So, Governor, what's life like out on the ranch here?
Well, the obvious is good. It's a good life. It's beautiful out here. There are animals, there are hawks, there are eagles flying around, there's wild boar, there's jackrabbits, squirrels, coyotes, and of course all the cows. So, and then there's over 300 different identified wildflowers right on this ranch. And they will start coming out now. A few have come out already. So it's a symphony of creation, which I'm right in the middle of. So I thoroughly enjoy it.
You have wildlife here. I imagine that you could probably describe being in the political arena as dealing with wildlife, just wildlife of a different kind.
Yeah, this is different. And I must say that when I let my dogs out, they go chase and often catch squirrels. And they proceed to twist their necks. So they're sweet, but predators. And the politics is a shark infested environment as well.
So who do you think politically has the toughest job in California right now?
The toughest job? First of all, a lot of the politicians don't really have tough jobs. You know, they got a nice job, they got a pension, the salary comes in whether you do anything or not. You get a lot of attention. It's exciting to some extent. Now, there's a lot of aggregation, a lot of aggravation, so that's a problem. I would say, well, in the city, the mayors, with the crime and the tents all that is very, it's not really getting that much, getting better, I don't think at all. Maybe some places it is. So that, I think that would be tough. Of course, the governor's job gets to be a problem. Now, mm-hmm. It can be very easy for a few years, and then things can go south on you, so.
You could have a pandemic and then a budget deficit.
You can have all of that. And we had Proposition 13, which cut the budget by 2/3. So that was real.
So since you left office, the players have changed in terms of some of the politicians, but a lot of the same issues are there.
Since I left office, things have gotten tougher.
Yeah.
the Republicans and Democrats get along less, mm-hmm. more polarization, more people identify more strongly with their thing or their belief, whether it's Democrat, Republican, conservative, liberal, they all hold on. But the truth of the matter is, life is complex enough that there isn't one ideology or belief system that's going to cover the complexity of our reality. And nevertheless, people pretend that they got an answer, which 9 times out of 10 they don't.
So is this freight train continuing to go and not stop in terms of the way politics is moving, or do you think everything is cyclical and we'll sort of have this course correction?
Well, I think it's cyclical, but I would tend to think things may get a little worse.
Oh.
Well, I mean, sitting out here, everything looks...
Everything looks great out here.
Well, it does look a little... Yeah, well, I don't know how long they'll allow that. I mean, things have evolved. You know, you got a lot of drug dealing on the streets, mm-hmm. even drug sales, and there doesn't seem to be any remedy. So that's the problem. I look at all these problems of people who can't take care of themselves and are engaged in all sorts of problems in the street. There are really three elements here. You need tougher laws, giving authority, like for conservatorships, or even people who are severely mentally ill. You can't let them sit in the tent and take fentanyl every day. And the second thing is you need someplace to put them. You need a shelter, and boy, that's expensive. And thirdly, you need skilled people, nurses, psychologists, psychiatrists, and we don't have enough of those. So we don't have the people, we don't have the places, and we don't have the laws. I would say that means trouble ahead.
And everything, all those tiers you mentioned, of course, cost money.
They cost money.
We're in a time of deficit. I recall, I think your 27 budget presentation, you said, you got to save money or you lose the farm. And when we were seeing these surpluses a couple of years ago here in California, you put out a warning sign saying, this isn't sustainable. And look, here we are. We're looking at a $22.5 billion, maybe exceeding that deficit. When you came into office, second time around, it was $27 billion. That's a big chunk of cash.
Well, yeah. The reason I could predict that is because I look back at all the other governors. Mm. And with a couple of exceptions, any governor that hangs around for 8 years runs into a recession. Sometimes very serious, as Schwarzenegger ran into, and Davis. Sometimes not so serious. So how bad this will be, I don't know. But the Federal Reserve is jacking up interest rates. That is going to slow down business, which will raise the unemployment rate, which will reduce the revenue to the state. And therefore, you'll get a bigger deficit. That's probably a good bet.
So what advice do you have for legislative leaders? Because everybody wants what they want. No, everyone says, we need to make cuts, but not cuts to what I want cuts to
be. The reason why cuts are hard is government is doing a lot of good stuff. Mm-hmm. When it comes time to cut, you're cutting good stuff, not bad stuff. But it's not an easy job. I just had a lunch with the Senate Pro Tem, and I listened. I didn't offer too many solutions.
You didn't? No. That's unlike you, right?
Well, I realize what a difficult job it is. And it is a bold. Governor Newsom with his care cards, that's bold. But it's just beginning. It's a baby step. And to get people to join in, there are a lot of people pushing back for various reasons, either the money or the authority of government, which they don't like, or some other reason, or maybe the whole licensing structure that makes it harder to get the personnel to be available.
So I want to cover as much as I can with you because it's such a unique opportunity to get you to weigh in on so many topics. I want to move to sort of a national level right now as we're getting into the presidential cycle. Yeah. You were, when we talked before, a big fan of Joe Biden and thought he was the right president for the right time, even though progressive members of the party were like, he's not progressive enough. Should he run for re-election, even though he hasn't announced yet?
Yeah, I'm not going to offer Brown says run or don't run. I'm going to leave that to the gods.
If it's Donald Trump on the other end.
Oh, well, yeah, Trump is unthinkable as a president. I don't think he's going to get it. He's going to get knocked off in his own Republican primary.
As it looks right now, there's not any sort of Democratic challenger that's
I think it's a very uncertain 2 years. Very uncertain. Republicans could win that. I think Biden's on a track to run for re-election, and it's challenging. The thing that concerns me most of all, well, a lot of things concern me, but the international field, this war in Ukraine, the danger of escalation to a full-scale war, even involving nuclear weapons, it's a small chance, but it's a real chance. And right now, we don't know how dangerous it is. That's why the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists, of which I'm the executive chair, we moved the doomsday clock 10 seconds closer to doomsday. It's a minute and a half away. And that's a metaphor, but it's scientists telling people this is real dangerous. Now, at the same time we got this problem in Ukraine, we're talking about defending Taiwan against China. Mm-hmm. So that could be another war in China. If somehow we encourage Taiwan to become independent or even close to that, then China may invade, and we're committed to go fight them. Now, at the same time, Iran is getting closer to building a nuclear weapon, and we said we're going to go stop that. So that could be another war. And then if we have North Korea, if they keep going, we may have to go to war with them. So you got four potential wars all over the world, and I don't hear many politicians talking about it. That's the number one challenge, as I see it.
Is that what keeps you up at night, if something were to keep you up at night?
Well, it can keep me up here. Yeah, well, I have a lot of time to think about it. I do think that foreign policy is way far from the public mind. It's not in the debate in the Democratic Party, or in some ways it's in the Republicans, because they're fanning the flames mm-hmm. for more antagonism. I don't think people realize how close we could be to a war and what that would mean in the total disruption of our way of life. And I just wish these people in Washington would think harder about finding some modus vivendi with these other countries, because we got to live on the planet Earth, and we got all these nuclear weapons, and there is a real danger they're going to use one of these days.
Well, I want to specifically ask you about China, too, because it seems every day that goes by, our relationship with them is getting more strained with the balloon and with arming
Russia. Well, that's a perfect example. A war with China would be unthinkable. I mean, it could go nuclear very quickly. And we get excited about a damn balloon. The balloon was not a problem. They have spies. We have spies. They got satellites. They have people hacking into our phones. Our National Security Administration was hacking the phone of Angela Merkel from Germany. Mm-hmm. So they're all doing it. The balloon, I mean, shut up. What we got to do is we got to find a way to work things out with China, or we're going to have a war, and if we have a war, America will never be what it is today.
And you've said a way to keep the dialogue with China in the past, and you did this while you were governor too, was climate. have conversations about climate.
Work on climate, work on the virus. There's some of these Republicans want to say, did the virus come from an animal or did it come from the lab? You know, it doesn't make any difference. That virus is only the beginning, according to the epidemiologists that I read, of more viruses to come. And what we need to do is to have the vaccines and the technologies to protect ourselves. To do that, we need Chinese scientists, and we need American scientists, and we need all the resources of the world working on this next threat that's just around the corner. Instead, we're worrying about balloons. We worry about this thing or that thing. Yeah, I know we're right, they're wrong, but that's not going to help. And when the nuclear bombs start coming, you would have said, gee, couldn't we have made some arrangement? Couldn't we compromise somehow? And I think we got to come back and focus on America. We talked about homelessness. We talked about, we haven't talked about it, but 20 to 30% of the people or more are living paycheck to paycheck. We have a changing climate. We have a real water shortage. We got all sorts. Our education, I mean, I know, I'm the chairman of charter school. Public education in California has tremendous challenges. We're underinvesting. So all that being said, let's take care of business at home. Let's not be stupid, but let's be thoughtful about working with people who have a very different view than we do. And when the stakes are nuclear war, and that means hundreds of millions potentially dying, I think you've got to go a long way before you get close to that catastrophe, if you're smart. Now, if you just think you're king of the world and, hey, whatever I want to do, I get to do, that's blindness. That's how we got into World War I. I think in many ways our hubris got us into Iraq and Afghanistan in a way that we were there for 20 years. 900,000 people died because of it. We've spent $8 trillion, or we will by the time we pay for all the benefits to the veterans. It's not a good thing. So my view is, yeah, we got some problems here in California, but the big international problems are not being addressed in a way that is maximizing our chance of avoiding disaster. I think we're flirting with danger, and I'm afraid there's a lot of people asleep at the switch.
So I want to shift to, I'm like, that was Governor Brown's mic drop. Maybe we should just leave it right there. I have to get this question in because there's this national conversation, and it ties into what you're saying of having, especially to a bygone era in politics where we don't want to talk to each other, we want to talk at each other. And now it seems like, especially members of Congress, everybody's focused on their own brand and running for re-election. And we even see it in the California legislature here. And I want to ask you your thoughts on term limits. We were sort of the first in the nation to enact term limits in 1990. Pete Shabarm, the LA County supervisor, you know, it was sort of targeted at Willie Brown. He was too powerful and corruption. And there have been some studies by the Public Policy Institute of California that it didn't turn out the way he wanted to. And now at a national level, you have Republicans like Senator Ted Cruz saying, we need term limits in Washington because, you know, we need new ideas and we need new people.
Yeah, you know he's not serious.
Most of them aren't because they don't want to lose their job.
But to get term limits, you need a constitutional amendment.
Right.
He knows that he's not going to get 2/3 of the Senate and the House and 3/4 of the states. So he can just, with complete impunity, put himself on the soapbox. Now, I advocated for term limits when I ran for president. Mm-hmm. But when I look back, yes, Willie Brown was quite strong and did things. He said, boy, don't we need to rein him in? Maybe. But the fact is, on balance, he was a lot better. He was one of the best we've ever had. Mm-hmm. He knew what he was doing. He had skill and he had longevity. So I think it's good. Now, of course, when I'm sitting here after being governor 16 years, I can't very well like cutting off that career. So I guess I thought if we're going to have term limits, we should do it once, maybe every 25 years. Say, okay, everybody runs. Mm-hmm. All bets are off. You can't run this for 2 years or 4 years, start over again. But the tight term limits of 8 years or 10 years, that doesn't make sense. I think there is, in some ways, I have to say, you have a choice. If you want people to be in all the time, they think they own the place, and you get arrogance. If you want to keep changing, you know, just musical chairs, then you get ignorance. So do you want ignorance or do you want arrogance?
You got to pick your poison, right?
No, but I do think that's, I'm being facetious. There is a lot of wisdom and skill. And yes, people don't like it because politics, you're making compromises. Mm-hmm. That's our problem in the international field. We're trying to be so pure, which is also pretty bogus, that we can't make compromises. The Republicans, not everything they believe, or the Democrats, is 100% right. They can make a deal, and they should for the country. But it's very narrow. People are very identified. You know, I'm a Republican, I'm a Democrat, I'm a progressive. Well, a lot of that stuff is way overblown. You got problems, they're complex, there are many different ways to skin a cat, not just Republican or Democrat. So I think we need to open up the system, but we're not. We're closing it down with more and more rigidity.
Out of all the positions you've held, you talked about being governor, mayor, running for president twice, secretary of state, attorney general, was there one that you liked the best?
Well, I think when I went back as mayor, I really enjoyed that because I was in Oakland. I lived there. I could cover the whole city in 15 minutes. And it's a real place. You saw condominiums being built. You saw restaurants being opened. You saw the police, you know, suppressing crime. I like that. I had schools. I started a couple of charter schools. Very concrete. So that was good. I have to tell you, I like running for president. Then I could kind of expound on my thoughts about the world. And I did learn a great deal. In running for president, you have to read and talk to people and interview generals and statesmen and policy people. So you learn a lot of things. So I do find that interesting. But I did think being mayor was good. Now, coming back to be governor was really good because I come back to the same office where I first went with my father. Was governor in 1959. I went to the Capitol there. And coming back after having been there for 8 years, that was also invigorating. And what I liked was there was one big problem called a $27 billion deficit. So everybody got focused, and we got it solved in 3 or 4 years. Now, it wasn't all the skill of the legislature or my office, because California was growing. So we grew out of it. And a lot of what happens in government, these are big forces, macro forces, global forces, and we ride them. But I would say coming back as governor and also restoring the governor's mansion. I know most people are never going in the governor's mansion, but I was there as a young man. I studied for the bar there, and it's a beautiful building, and meeting with legislators there I think it's historic. It's serious. There's a certain gravity. So I like that. But I also like restoring the Mountain House. Because when I was a little boy, my grandmother Ida Shuckman was her name, she would read me Bible stories. And she would also tell me about the Mountain House and how wonderful it was. And people would come by this road right out here, which is Leesville Road. They would come by this road in stagecoaches, and they would stay at the hotel that was right 100 yards from where we were sitting. And she said, it's very special. So that kind of echoed in my mind. I said, okay, that's where I want to be. So I've restored this. We got solar collectors. We're off the grid. We've restored the barns. We have a well. We got water. There's tanks up on the hill. The water comes down by gravity. So that's good too. So not one thing, not one job, but a life that I found very, very fascinating.